Ligaaraw sa inyo. Okay. Ligayang araw, Miss Magdaong, Miss Mirano, Miss Martini, Miss General, Miss Del Rosario, Miss David, Mr. David Bill, Mr. Chua, Miss Pino, everybody else. Okay. Dami nyo eh. Ganare, pag-uusapan natin, pinag-usapan natin siya na si George Boole last time. Paano niya na-invento yung mathematical logic. Bilhin natin ng kaunti. And then we move on dun sa next generation. The next generation, it took a while for the ideas of George Boole to take root, but inevitably, it has taken root in the works of Gottlob Frege. And then, another generation, yung sumunod, doon naman sa work ni Bertrand Russell. Yung work doon, tatlo na yan, napaka-importante sa information communication technology. Mukha lamang simple, but in the long run, napakalaki pala ng kinalaman sa ating buhay ngayon. Okay. Share tayo na screen, ha? Yung mga gusto sumama sa live, sampo ang inimbitahan ko. Okay, kaya saan yung share screen natin? Sampo ang inimbitahan ko doon sa email. But it's up to you, no? Baka ayaw yung sumali. Di okay lang. Okay, review tayo. George Boole. Sino si George Boole? Mathematics professor. Saan? Sa Queen's College. Excuse me. Queen's College sa Ireland. Yun ang pinakang UP ng Ireland. Si George Boole, we consider him as the father of mathematical logic, inventor of mathematical logic. Father or inventor of mathematical logic. Bahala kayo sa buhay niyo. For our purposes, reviewin lang natin. Ang ginawa ni George Boole ay pinag-aralan niya yung conflict or yung inconsistency or yung contradiction between definition of mathematics na ancient Greeks at practice nung panahon niya ng mga inventors. Panahon niya, age of inventors ang tawag dyan eh. Ngayon, in the process, hopefully natatandaan niyo pa, in the process, sabi niya, hindi, pang sinabi nating tama yung mga Greeks by saying that mathematics is the study of numbers and numbers are about measurement or magnitude, then dapat sasabihin din natin na when you encounter so-called impossible numbers, dapat yung ginagawa mo, ipagtigil mo or ayusin mo muna dahil impossible numbers indicate human error. So, ang sinasabi ni Diyos, pag tama ang mga Greeks, may problema tayo kasi yung mga inventors of this time, maraming calculations na ginagawa and they deal with impossible numbers. But at the same time, they produce items, inventions that everybody loves. So, sabi niya, it's difficult, but we have to make a decision. We either say the Greeks are correct and therefore the inventors are wrong, or the inventors are correct and therefore the Greeks are wrong. And he chooses, the Greeks are wrong. If the Greeks are wrong, then sabi niya, we must redefine mathematics. And he redefines mathematics and says that mathematics is about relations. It's not about measurement or magnitude. It may be about measurement or magnitude, but that's just accidental. What is important is that mathematics is about relations. Now, the study of relations is, in fact, already something known to everyone. It's called logic, the study of patterns. The study of patterns involves the study of relations. And he says that logic, therefore, in a manner of speaking, should be considered as the foundation of mathematics. Now, if you consider the foundation of mathematics as logic, then you're in luck. Bakit? Kasi sabi ni George Boole, matagal nang gustong i-unify ang mathematics ng maraming intellectuals eh. Walang makagawa-gawa niyan. Baka ako na makakagawa niyan kasi they've never known that the foundation of mathematics is logic. And so George Boole says, well, that's what I'm going to do. Unify all of mathematics into a single system, just like Euclidean geometry has been able to unify all of knowledge about space into a single system. Sabi niya, I will unify mathematics on the basis of logic. But he fails. But then when he fails, he gets to ask the question, so what's wrong? Why am I not able to unify mathematics on the basis of logic, on a foundation of logic? Kasi yung discipline ng logic, eh, hindi siya mature. Yung discipline ng mathematics, highly mature. Now, ano yung dahilan? Bakit nag-mature yung mathematics? Kasi yung mathematics gumagamit ng symbolic language. Ergo, his proposal to use symbolic language in the study of logic. Kaya merong expression, ano yung expression? Modern symbolic logic, which is another way of calling mathematical logic or modern symbolic logic. Yan. And so he says, when we study logic, we should use symbolic language. Yan. Ngayon, ito yung problema. Pinakita lang niya yung paggamit ng symbolic language to express relations. To express relations. You see, ganito. When you deal with relations in the form of our expressions in language. Halimbawa, meron kang statement, this table is brown and this table is small. You're actually relating, in this case, the sentence, this table, to the sentence, this table is brown, to the sentence, this table is small. And there is a tool that you're using to identify the relationship. You can also express a sentence like this, this table is brown, or this table is ochre in color. So this is another way of looking at another kind of relationship. You are relating this sentence, this table is brown, to this sentence, this table is ochre, using another type of relationship, or. And you can say, this table is brown if and only if this table is ochre in color, which is another kind of relationship that you can express using your language. Here you will notice you are now relating the sentence, this table is brown, to the sentence, this table is ochre, using a different kind of relationship, if and only if. And finally, you have this expression, this table is brown, hence or therefore, dito natin. We have another way of doing this, Ito na lang. If this table is brown, then, hence, then, this table is ochre in color. Or balik ka rin natin, if this table is ochre in color, Dito natin ha. If this table is ochre in color, then this table is necessarily brown. This table is brown. you will notice we are again relating two sentences here. This table is ochre, so this table is brown, using a different kind of relationship. If then. Now, hindi na natin titingnan. Ang ginawa ni George Boole, yung iba-ibang klaseng relationship na yon, using and, or, if and only if, and if then, nilagay niya in symbolic form. What we today call Boolean logic. Of course, nung panahon niya, hindi Boolean logic ang tawag. Pero ngayon, Boolean logic ang tawag natin. Now, hindi ko na ipapakita. Sinimbolize niya. Nung sinimbolize niya, hindi pa naman niya ginagamit yung symbolic language niya to analyze arguments. Ang nag-analyze ng argument using symbolic language ay are. Si Gottlob Frege, that's one, at saka si Bertrand Russell. Si Bertrand Russell, yan. Yan, dalawa na yan ang may kasalanan. Kaya kayo maghihirap nitong first half of the semester. Kasi yung symbolic language ni George Boole dinagdagan pa ng requirement ni Gottlob Frege. Mamaya ako ikukwento. And then dahil doon sa ginawa niya, applicable na ngayon yung ginagawa ni yung symbolic language ni George Boole, applicable na ngayon sa analysis of arguments. Okay. So, ganito, no? We have terms. And we say, well, terms have the dimension of meaning. And we use them to refer to meanings. So, we use them to refer with. Okay, that's yung takbo na usapan natin. Now, you put together terms, what do you get? You have your sentences. Now, your sentences have the dimension of meaning and the dimension of truth. So, you have meaning and truth. Now, focus your attention on truth. Sabi nga natin maraming gamit yung knowledge ng truth You know, some sentences are always, sabihin na muna natin, ano? Sentences have their own use. We use them to express our thoughts with the thought that this table is brown. That's not the same as the idea of brownness or the idea of tableness, if you can say so. The thought is different from the idea. And to express your thought, you use a sentence. So, to express our thoughts with, we use the sentence. Yan. Ngayon, punta tayo din sa truth. Yan, ano? May dimension of meaning, may dimension of truth. Some sentences are always true. Always true. Now, what else? Well, some sentences are sometimes true. Sometimes false. Yan. Now, ano yung always true? Example, if it rains, then it rains. Whether you're dead or alive, awake or asleep, that sentence is always going to be true. Tama ba? Yan. Yan nga, tingnan natin itong ating ginagawa. Okay. Balik tayo din eh. Okay. Now, some sentences are sometimes true, sometimes false, like the sentence, "This table is brown." If you were, say, in my room, you point to the table in my room and you say, "This table is brown," that's true. But if you go to the university chapel, alam niyo na, yung mukhang flying saucer, yung mukhang spaceship. If you go to the university chapel, you point to the table over yonder and say, "This table is brown," the sentence will have to be false. Why? Because your table doon ay marble white. So sometimes true, sometimes false. We call those sentences that are always true, we call them tautologies. Tautologies. We call sentences that are sometimes true, sometimes false, we call them contingent sentences. Now, sentences. Now, merong weird na klase ng sentence. Ano yung weird na klase ng sentence? Yung tinatawag nating contradictions. Okay. Contradictions. Contradictions are sentences that appear to be true and false at the same time. Halimbawa, yung sentence, "I am a liar." If somebody tells you, "I'm a liar," you'll have a problem. Why? Because if the fellow you're talking to says, "I am a liar," then what he says is a lie. But if what he says is a lie, then what he says is false. If what he says is false, then you'll have a problem. Why? Because if what he says is false, and what did he say? "I'm a liar," then "I'm a liar" is false, then therefore you are not a liar. But if you are not a liar, and you've just said, "I am a liar," then you lied. But then, if you lied, then you're a liar. So, then, you're a liar, you can now say, "I'm a liar." But then, when you say, "I'm a liar," again, we go back to the same situation. And so, your sentence, "I'm a liar," appears in a way to be true and false at the same time. We call them contradictions. Yan. Contradictions are very similar to what we call oxymorons, you know, terms that somehow appear to be right and wrong at the same time. Like for example, ano nga ba example natin oxymoron? Sandali ah. Bitter, sweet. Eh, bitter na. Tapos sabi mo, sweet. Eh, di, naloko na. Yan. Bakit importante yung pinaliwanag natin ngayon? Look. If you think of your minds as a basket full of thoughts, in particular, thoughts that you call rules or principles, when you relate those rules to one another, there is a catch. First, when you are able to relate those rules to one another, like the rules of physics to the rules of chemistry, and the rules of chemistry to the rules of biology, and the rules of biology to the rules of psychology, and the rules of psychology, you relate them to the rules of sociology. You know what I'm talking about. Then you'll be able to predict, for example, the political behavior of a society. Then you'll be able to predict, for example, the behavior of a civilization. That's the catch. the way our thoughts hang together, if we understand this, we are able to predict and therefore have control over our lives. But then, that requires coherence. And ano sabi nga natin? Pagka very coherent ang iyong thoughts, that means very reliable ang iyong prediction. But then, it is actually possible that your thoughts are not coherent. And if your thoughts are not coherent, that means your prediction may not be reliable. And this happens when your thoughts are full of contradictions. Pagka meron kang contradiction, Miss Henrao, nandiyan ka pa ba? Pag meron kang contradiction sa buhay, halimbawa, pero kung nakitang taga-UP na classmate mo, ang gwapo-gwapo, ay type ko siya, ang gwapo-gwapo. Tapos nalaman mo, ay hindi ko rin siya type, bakit ang bao-bao ng kilikili. Meron kang contradiction kasi sabi mo, type mo. Pagkataas, sabi mo, hindi mo type. Yan. Pagka ganon, may general, nagkakaroon ka ng contradiction sa buhay, anong ginagawa mo? Ay di ikaw ay natutuliro. Pag natuliro ka na, Miss Martini, ano ngayon gagawin mo? Ay di kakanta ng Torete. Mamaya, sikat ka na. Mamaya, tinatranslate na sa Japanese yung kanta mo. That's what happens when our thoughts are full of contradictions. Natutorete tayo. Pag natutorete ka, yung prediction, yung thought, yung prediction mo, hindi na reliable. Ngayon, ang tanong paano natin makikita how our thoughts relate to one another in some mathematical sense? There is a connection between them. And that's when we move on and deal with what we call arguments. Ay, no, hindi ko na-share. Ulit. Ang ating thoughts, sabi nga natin, have to relate to one another in some coherent way. Now the question is, how do we actually see how they relate to one another? We already gave one example. One day, the sun is rising from the east. Another day, the sun is rising from the east. Another day, and so many days. And so, you now say, well, as a rule, as a pattern, whenever the sun rises, it rises from the east. Then you now say, if tomorrow the sun will rise from the east. And what we want to do is we want to mathematicize how all of these relationships can be handled. And this brings us to the nature of arguments. Why? When you put sentences together, you end up with paragraphs. Now, paragraphs have many uses. Some paragraphs are used to narrate with, some paragraphs are used to iterate or enumerate with, some paragraphs are used to describe with, but there are paragraphs that we want to focus on. Those are paragraphs that we use to argue with. In other words, paragraphs that we use to reason with. Yan. With our capacity to reason, we are able to say, tomorrow the sun will rise from the east. Now, ang arguments merong tatlong, ano tawag dito? Sabi nga natin, ano? Pinag-usapan na natin. I'm just reviewing just to make sure everybody understands. Arguments, meron tatlong dimensions. The dimension of form, the dimension of content, and the dimension of context. Yan. And sabi natin, ang most basic requirement ay dimension of form. And so when we focus on form, dito ang focus natin, when we focus on form, how do you decide form? You decide form using mathematics. we decide what form is all about using mathematics. Yan. Yung content and context saka na natin pag-usapan. No? So you have arguments that are tools, tools that we reason with. You have sentences that are tools, tools that we express our thoughts with. You have terms that are tools that we use as tools, tools to refer with. Refer to what? The meaning or the concept or the idea. Okay. So, review ko kahaba ng review natin. Mr. Mendoza, tanong nga. Tama ba, Mr. Mendoza, na napag-usapan natin yan? Yung dimensions of reasoning. Tatanda ko, napag-usapan natin eh. Anyone, pakisagot nga. I just want to make sure, and I'm reviewing because if you don't understand these basic items that I am dealing with right now, it will be very difficult for you to understand what's going to happen later. Eh. Okay, Ms. Ibera. Dami salamat ha, Mr. Mendoza. Ayan, Mr. Adriano, Ms. Adriano. Very good. Galiya, inom lang ako. Ang sabi natin, ang unang-unang gagawin pag mag-mathematicize, salamat, Ms. Espino. Ang sabi natin, Ms. Castro, Ms. Martinez, ang sabi natin, ang unang-unang gagawin natin pag mag-mathematicize, pag mag-mathematicize tayo, ang sabi natin, gagamit tayo ng symbolic language. Ah, ulitin natin. First step, gamit tayo ng symbolic language. And pag gagamit tayo ng symbolic language, sabi nga natin, maraming advantages. Sino nagsabi niyan? Si George Boole. George Boole says, use symbolic language and that's the first step in mathematicizing. Okay. Sabi nga natin, ano, ang symbolic language merong advantages. It is economical. We are able to relegate aside content and therefore focus more on form. Yan, binanggit ko yan sa inyo. Inuwento ko yung great-grandfather ko na katipunero. Yan. And then, yung pangatlo, ito yung hindi masyadong maliwanag. Eh. Nagmamadali kasi ako. Eh. But let's now repeat it. Yung pangatlo, we're able to highlight form. Therefore, we're able to focus more on form. And therefore, comparison and contrast or contrast comparison or contrast of arguments become more manageable, okay, easier to handle. Yan, yun ang gusto nating mangyari. So we can handle better our arguments. Yan, ano? So we have this. Pinag-usapan na natin yan. Ito rin. Ito rin. At ang example ko nga, ano? Yung si Amy. At saka, sino nga ba yun? Miss General na ano? Na boyfriend ni Amy na magaling mag-focus kaya hindi siya napapansin doon sa Big Bang Theory. You know what I'm talking about? Si Sheldon. Yan. Okay. Now, dyan tayo napatid nung nag-uusap tayo eh. So, tuloy natin. Ano? Yung ginawa ni George Boole, sinabi lang niya, mathematical lang gamitin na language eh. Pero, binathematicize niya yung how we relate thoughts to one another. And later, naging importante yan. Paano naging importante ito? Paliwanag natin. So, sinimbolize niya. That's it. Yung how we relate thoughts to one another. Now, how do those symbols become useful in analyzing arguments, that's another matter. Ang gumawa niyan, nagpakita niyan, ay si Gottlob Frege at saka si Bertrand Russell. Ganito. So, tuwang-tawa si George Boole, sabi niya, now I know we can unify mathematics using logic as a foundation. And then, he's so happy, he tries, and then he fails. But in the process, he gets to become the father of mathematical logic. Alam niyo ng kwento. Ito ngayon si Gottlob Frege. Sa dinami-dami ng tao sa mundo na nakabasa ng work ni George Boole, doon sa England, walang masyadong nagka-interest. Ang nagka-interest, taga-Germany. Sa Germany, ito nga si Gottlob Frege, Austria. Sabi nga ni Gottlob Frege, ay pag-aralan ko ito, kagaling nito ha. And so, sabi niya, kaya hindi na-unify ni Gottlob, ni George Boole ang mathematics kasi hindi niya alam kung paano may interpret ang mathematics in terms of logical relationships. Na-symbolize lang niya, pero hindi niya nakita eh. Sabi niya, ito yung nakita ko eh, sabi ni Gottlob Frege. Remember, ang uso na logic nung panahon na yon ay Aristotelian logic. Yung Aristotelian logic, maraming famous examples na pag-aaral. And let me give you one, Gottlob Frege. Sabi ni Gottlob Frege, tingnan niyo itong isang argument na ito. All men are mortal. Yan, na favorite example to ni Aristotle. So one sentence, second sentence, Socrates is mortal. Therefore, yan. Ay, sorry. Socrates is a man. Nagloko na. Sorry, mamali. Socrates is a man. Yan. Therefore, Socrates is mortal. Yan. Oh, talaga naman, no? Hindi ako nakapag-breakfast ng maayos. Eh, kasi nag-plancha pa ako at naglaba. Yan, ha? All men are mortal. Socrates is a man. Therefore, Socrates is mortal. Of course, we know that's a very valid argument. Now, the point is, sabi ni Gottlob Frege, look, if you look at this sentence na very famous among scholars of Aristotelian logic, you will see that there is a set of all men relative to the set of mortals, relative to the set of men, as we've already pointed out. So, and here you have someone who belongs to the set. Set of men, set of mortals. So, the point is, sabi ni Gottlob Frege, ang pag-aaral ng Aristotelian logic para maging compatible sa pag-aaral ng mathematics ay dapat interpret mo Aristotelian logic in terms of set. Yan. And so, sabi niya, ito yung solution. Kung gagawan mo ng style Euclidean geometry, so you have your axioms. If you remember, discussion natin ng Euclidean geometry. Out of your axioms, you derive your principles. Out of your principles, you derive more principles. So that in the long run, you end up with an inverted pyramid system of highly mathematical deductive relationships. Sabi niya, dapat yung axioms mo ay about sets. Yan. Ergo, set theory. Yun ang sinasabi ni Gottlob Frege. Dapat ang foundation mo, rules of set theory. Kasi sa mathematics, meron talagang pag-aaral about the nature of sets. And so, sabi ni Gottlob Frege, ganito gagawin ko. Instead of focusing on Aristotelian logic, I will focus on set theory. as an interpretation of the language of Aristotelian logic in mathematics, like translating Filipino into English. You translate from Aristotelian logic into mathematics, you end up with set theory. Sabi niya, from set theory, I will derive all of the rules of mathematics, style Euclidean geometry. And guess what? For the first time in the history of mankind, here is a person who is able to finally, big time, finally unify all of mathematics into a single system. Yan si Gottlob Frege. Yan nga si Vera, si Amy at saka si Sheldon. Si Amy, si Sheldon kasi pag nag-focus, focus na focus eh, kasi geek. Kasi he thinks in symbolic language. And therefore, napapabayaan si Amy na pagulong-gulong sa tabi, magpapakamatay na hindi pinapansin. Although, nagpakasal din sila, di ba? Okay, balik tayo sa usapan natin. So, tumantawa si Gottlob Frege. Sabi niya, po, tayo na. I'm going to be famous. And so, bilis-bilis siya, no? Ipapublish niya yung libro. Pero sabi niya, before I even publish the book, I'll publish the essay. So he published an essay telling everyone how mathematics can be unified into a single system, style Euclidean geometry. Sabi niya, I'm so successful. I'm so happy to tell everybody. And overnight, he became a celebrity. Na leche, bakit? Kasi merong isang bata, ito yung pangalan niya, no? So tingnan natin. Ito si Gottlob Frege. Sabi ko nga sa inyo, yung naunang henerasyon ay sino? Si George Boole, no? He lived from 1815 to 1864. 1854 niya isinulat yung libro niya on modern symbolic logic. Ito, o libro niya na sinulat niya na naging basis ng modern symbolic logic. Ang sabi ni George Boole, use symbolic language. Ito ngayon si George Gottlob Frege. Si Gottlob Frege lived from 1848 to 1925, so second generation. Sabi niya, I will finally unify all of mathematics into a single system. So you have here your axioms, and out of your axioms, you derive your other rules, and so you end up with a whole system of rules founded on set theory, remember? The rules of set theory. Eh, nagawa niya. Dito ang tuwa siya. Nagkataon naman, may isang bata. Bata pa eh. Ang pangalan, Bertrand Russell. Although sa photograph eh, mukhang matanda na siya, no? But the young Bertrand Russell, I think he was in early 20s when in the 1890s, okay, sulat natin. 1890s, pinakita ni Gottlob Frege paano ma-unify ang mathematics using set theory. Now remember, ito, tingnan natin, 1872 eh. So, teenager pa lang pala siya, 1890. Something that, anyway, very young man si Bertrand Russell, binasa niya yung work ni Gottlob Frege. At nung binasa niya yung work ni Gottlob Frege, sabi niya, wow, ang galing naman ito. Tuwan-tuwa siya. But then, later on, he stumbled upon what we today call Russell's Paradox. Russell's Paradox, or sometimes called Russell's Antimony. Mukhang simple lang to pero nakakatuwa. Maraming nangyari sa buhay natin sa buong mundo dahil dito sa paradox ni Russell. Hanggang ngayon, apektado tayo. Sometimes called Russell's Antimony. Ano ito nangyari? Sabi ni Russell, Sir, excuse me, itong system niyo bulok. Sabi niya, hindi mo pwedeng gamitin foundation ng set ng unification of mathematics yung set theory. Yun, sinabi ni Bertrand Russell, naloko na. So meron siyang objection. Ay di sabi ni Gottlob Frege, po tayo naman tong bata na to eh. Let me tell everyone something. Noong sumulat si Russell kay Gottlob Frege, he was studying in the same university. While Russell was a young man, Englishman, mayaman, nag-aral siya dun sa Austria, dun sa university ni Gottlob Frege. And then, he stumbled upon the work of Gottlob Frege and sabi niya ito, Sir, malabo yan, hindi nagawa mo. And nung sinabi niya yun, around 2 weeks na lang mapapublish na yung libro ni Gottlob Frege. Kasi ang una na publish, paper lang eh. Tapos finally, may libro na. Sabi niya, I can die happily. 2 weeks na lang, lalabas na yung libro. Ay puta na, dumating yung sulat ni Russell. Alam niya ba ang nangyari kay Gottlob Frege? Nilagnat na hospital for 2 days. The first recorded in history of a scholar becoming so ill, having found out about an intellectual problem. Dalawang araw na hospital yung profesor. Naloko na. Ito. Sabi ni Bertrand Russell ganito. If you have the word set, remember, ha? Salamat kay Pythagoras the LGBT. Adik ang lahat ng mga philosophers and therefore ito si Bertrand Russell, Gottlob Frege, George Boole. Adik sila saan? Sa coherence. Now, there is something incoherent about the word set. When you have the word set, what are you going to say? Well, you have a word set, which means you have a number of things within a domain. So, number of things, say A, B, C. Now, those things belong to the same domain because you can describe them. So, to be able to have a set is to be able to describe the members of the set. Conversely, if you can describe the members of the set, then you have a set. So, to have a set, to have a description. To have a description, to have a set. Yan. Okay, ulitin natin. How do you know you have a set? Because you are able to describe the members of the set. Let's say the set of all things called chairs. Well, all of them are sat upon. All of them are pieces of furniture, so you can describe. But then on the other hand, if you have many things that you can describe together, let me repeat, if you have many things that you can describe together, by definition, you have a set. So to have a set is to have a description. To have a description is to have a set. We have a definite description. That's the expression. Definite description. Now, this is the problem. There are many kinds of sets according to George Boole. According to Gottlob Frege. You have a set with only one member. Yan, halimbawa, ano yung set na yan? Si Professor de Villa, yun ang description. Professor ng UP, yan ang description. You can have a set na dalawang tao ang nandyan. Si Professor de Villa at asawa niya. Yan, ang mag-asawang de Villa. You can have a set with three members. Yung mag-asawang de Villa at saka yung kabit ni Professor de Villa. Yan, girlfriend. Sorry ha, wala akong girlfriend. Boyfriend, meron. Nagbibiro lang ako. So, teka, tanungin ko kayo, baka daldal ako ng daldal eh. Yan, Miss Magdaong, okay, may betrayal, may objection si Bertrand Russell. Sabi niya, maraming klase ng set eh. Ngayon, pag may description ka, pwedeng isa lang yung member ng set mo. Isa lang mag-fit doon eh. Pag may description ka, pwedeng dalawa, pwedeng tatlo, pwedeng ang dami-dami, pwedeng infinite. Pag wala kang description, meron kang set. Ang tawag doon ay ano, null set. Yan. So, merong null set. Now, focus your attention on Miss Martini, pasaklap nga yan si Amy. Focus your description, Miss Martini, on focus your mind on the description of one member of a set. Yan. Or put it this way, let us focus on this kind of set. This kind of set. And let us describe the member of the set. Okay, I'll describe the member of the set. The member of the set is a Borrow group. Now, notice when you say the member of the set is a Borrow group, you don't understand anything. Sabi nga natin, the expression is meaningless because we do not know the truth conditions and we do not know the falsifying conditions. Remember, the meaning of sentences. So we don't know the truth conditions, we don't know the falsifying conditions. This becomes a meaningless sentence. Okay. Erase, 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 meaning the sentence to end in dictionary. Now, what happens if you have this kind of sentence? The member is something that does not belong to a set. That's another matter. Why? Notice that this sentence is a very meaningful sentence. Why? Because you know the truth and falsifying conditions involving the sentence. Yan. So, we know the truth and falsifying conditions of the sentence. And what's the sentence? The member is something that does not belong to a set. So if you have such a description, you have a set. But if you look at the member of the set, it does not belong to any set. Meron ka kayong contradiction. So because you have a description, check. Then you have a set. But then when you look at the set, the member of the set is something that does not belong to any set. So you have now a problem. In other words, the word set is ambiguous. It's unclear. The word set becomes ambiguous, becomes confusing. So if the word set is confusing at some point, ay, talaga naman, no? Hindi ko na. If the word set is confusing at some point, okay, balik tayo din sa akin, ha? If the word set is confusing at some point, then set theory becomes confusing. And therefore, anything derived of set theory becomes confusing. Ergo, sabi ni Bertrand Russell, puta na yung ginawa mo, bulok, bulok, bulok. Na-hospital si Frege kasi hindi niya masagot. So here now is Frege, sabi niya. Pag-aralan ko nga ang meaning ng meaning. Yan, ha? Ulitin natin. Sabi niya, pag-aralan ko nga ang meaning na word, meaning. So all of a sudden, Bertrand Gottlob Frege now is into the study of language and the study of meaning. Yan. Ano ba yung meaning? Ano ba yung meaning ng word set? Yan. Dali, ha? Sandali lang. So, yan. Ito ngayon. Okay. So, sabi niya, what do you mean when you say the word set? What do you mean by meaning? And, oh, ito na ngayon. Hindi ko binanggit ito dati. Siya naka-discover. Remember, mayroong classic theories. Yung classic theories ng meaning ay ano, referential theory. Nasabi natin, miski mga yung umimbento ng referential theory, ay sabi niya, may limitation yan. Ano yung isa, ideational theory. Si Gottlob Frege ang nagpakita ng limits ng ideational theory. Sabi ni Gottlob Frege, ideas are private, but words are public. Si Gottlob Frege ang nagsabi niyan. Kasi nga, pinag-aaralan niya kung paano sasagutin si Bertrand Russell eh. Kaya naging classic theory na rin yung ideational theory. Thanks to Gottlob Frege. So sabi ni Gottlob Frege, ang ibig sabihin niyan, ayaw natin ng ideational theory. Ayaw na rin natin ng referential theory. So anong paliwanag mo ng meaning? Sabi ni Gottlob Frege, ito yung paliwanag ng meaning. Ergo, what we call today, Fregean theory of meaning. Pero hindi nyo kailangan malaman ng details nito. Basta sabi lang niya, ganung theory ako, ganito. Sabi niya, take something, an object. Notice that the object, you may call it Venus. Okay. Call it Venus. But then Venus sometimes appears in the morning and it is called, rather than called Venus, it is called the morning star. Oo nga naman. Lalo na yung mga taong walang alam sa astronomy. Morning star ang tawag nila dyan. Pero sometimes it appears in the evening and it is called the evening star. Oo nga naman. Maraming ganyan. Tawag dyan, evening star. But they're all, meaning to say, these expressions, they're all about the same object. Yan. So you can say, well, there is sense in looking at Venus, at the object as Venus. So meron nga namang sense yan. Nakakaiba doon sa ibang sense. So tawagin natin yan, sense number one. There's another sense in looking at the same object. Tawagin natin yan, sense number two. Yan. Okay? Oo nga naman. And there's another sense in looking at the object. Tawagin natin yan, sense number three. Yan. Now, kung ano man yung implications niyan, huwag na muna nating punta ng detalye. And sinasabi niya na all of these are related to one another. How you look at your object with your different senses. But kung ano man yung sinasabi niya, sige, bahala ka sa buhay mo. Meron pang isang na-discover si Frege. Sabi niya, ang meaning of a sentence ang meaning of the term is not the same as meaning of the sentence. Yan. And ito na nga ang sabi natin, when you use the term to identify a meaning, you identify an idea or a concept. But when you say sentence, you identify the meaning not of the idea or the concept, you identify the meaning of the thought. And at some point in time, the thought can be itself true or false. Or sometimes the thought itself can neither be true nor false, but nevertheless meaningful. And dun nga sinasabi natin, lumalabas yung paliwanag na to be able to know the meaning of a sentence, you must know the truth conditions and the falsifying conditions. Now, so maliwanag naman yan, pinag-usapan na natin eh. Sabi ni Gottlob Frege, they are not the same. The meaning of a sentence is about knowledge of truth and falsifying conditions, not about knowledge of some idea or concept. Okay, very good. Ano ngayon? Nalaman ni Gottlob Frege na meron nga pala tayong simple sentences, meaning to say one sentence, like this table is brown. Meron tayong compound sentences. Okay. Okay, like the sentence, this table is brown and this table is small. Yan. Okay. And meron tayong tinatawag natin na complex sentences. Sabi ni Gordon Frege, okay, ano yung complex sentences? Eh, kagaya nito. This table is brown and this table is small. And in addition, it is also this table is also chintzy. Mumurahin. And of course, complex sentences can be composed of three or more sentences. Oh, alam na natin yan. Well, eh, ito yung punto. Yan. Eh, dahil geek nga to si, ano eh, si Gottlob Frege eh. Ang mga geek, ano, ano mga pinaggagawa eh. Focus here. Yung pag-aaral niya nito, may nangyari. Ano nangyari? Yung pag-aaral niya niyan, may na-discover siya. Well, for one, na-discover niya na ano, all complex sentences from his point of view, all complex sentences are in fact compound. Yeah. So, supposing you have the sentence, this table is brown. Okay. And you say, this table is small. Okay. Notice that if you now say, in addition, this table is chintzy, you end up with a compound still. Why? Because this is one sentence X, and this is now your sentence C. It is a compound. Okay? Kahit nadagdagan mo ito, this table is brown and this table is small, and this table is chintzy, and this table is long. Kahit nadagdagan mo pa yan, you always end up with a compound. So isa yung nakita ni ano ano ni Gottlob Frege. Okay, sige, given, dali naman 'yan eh. So all complex sentences are compound sentences, ano? Now, notice you can actually have this kind of sentence. Okay? If I am going to Spain, then I will need a passport. Okay. In this sentence, you have a compound. And the compound is possible because of the expression if then. Okay, eh, ano ngayon? Now, sabi nga natin, marami expressions ng compound sentences. You have the expression, this table is brown and this table is small. Yan. You have the expression, this table is brown or this table is small. You have the expression or. They are all compounds, di ba? Or you can say, this table is brown if and only if this table is ochre, if and only if it is brown. So, you have now the expression if and only if. Okay? These are all expressions of relationships. So, ano ngayon? Ganito. Supposing you have the sentence S, this table is small. Oh, sorry. Let me repeat. Supposing you have the sentence B, this table is brown. And you connect it to the sentence S, this table is small. And you connect this to the sentence chintzy, this table is chintzy. You now have here a complex or a compound. Now, being a complex or a compound, you will notice each and every one of them can be true or false. So B can be true or false. S can be true or false. C can be true or false. What does that mean? That means you have many possibilities. One possibility is all of these sentences are true. All the way to the possibility that all of these sentences are false. Between them, there will be many combinations. Napansin yan ni Gottlob Frege dun sa kanyang pag-aaral ng nature of compound and complex sentences. So you have these possibilities, many, many possible combinations. Yan. Sabi niya. Yung mga possible combinations na yan, ihanay natin, ha? Halimbawa. So, ihanay natin, halimbawa. Okay, sandali lang. Pagka ganito ang arrangement ninyo, lahat ng possibilities, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, yan. Pagka ganito ang ginawa ninyo, you will have all the combinations. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, yan, ano? 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2. Notice, you have here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You have 8 combinations kasi dalawa rito times dalawa rito times dalawa rito, that's 8. Now, ito yung tinanong ni Gottlob Frege na has never been asked in the entire history of mankind. Sabi niya, as you go up and down, you have different combinations. As you go up and down, you have different combinations. Now, what does that mean? Notice that this itself can either be true or false. This entire sentence itself, the entire complex, can either be true or false. So, ang tanong ni Frege, ito bang up and down na ito? Na ito? Ay may correlation doon sa left and right na ito. In other words, pag siya'y lahat ay true, nagiging true. Pag siya'y lahat ay false, nagiging false. Yun. And, obviously, ang sagot ni Gottlob Frege ay, ba't ba nagkaganyan yan? Tingnan natin dito. Obviously, ang sagot ni Gottlob Frege ay, yes. Ay, sorry. Hindi na nga lang tayo sa akin. Sabi ni Gottlob Frege, obviously, as you go up and down, your value of the sentence becomes left or right in a very predictable way. In the same manner that as your cosine changes in value, your sine changes in value, and therefore your tangent and cotangent changes in value. Oo nga naman. So, parang kung meron kang trigonometric table, meron kang table na pang-analyze ng compound or complex sentences. Let me repeat, compound and complex sentences. Hindi natapos dyan. Sabi ni Gottlob Frege, remember, when you have the sentence, if I am going to Spain, then I will need a passport. And if you add to that sentence another sentence, I am going to Spain, then you get a conclusion, therefore, I will need a passport. In other words, take note, if you have this argument, you have a paragraph, you have an argument. Now this argument, when you claim this, it is as if to say, if it is true that I'm going to Spain, then if it is true that if I'm going to Spain, if it is true that if I am going to Spain, then I will need a passport. And it is also true that I am going to Spain, and in addition, therefore, in addition, it is also true. And then ulitin natin. Sorry, ganito, ulitin natin. If it is true that if I'm going to Spain, I will need a passport, and it is also true that I'm going to Spain, then it must be true that I will need a passport. Okay, meron tayo ditong idadagdag, ha? Dito natin. Ay, sorry. Hindi pala ako. So, that. Okay. Well, anyway, ganito na lang, ha? Take this sentence, very long sentence, ano? This sentence is in fact a compound. Let me now symbolize it para mas madali. Ito yung ibig sabihin niyan. If it is true that if I'm going to Spain, then I will need a passport. And it is true that indeed I'm going to Spain, then it must be true that I will need a passport. Yan ang gusto nating sabihin. In other words, all arguments from the point of view of Frege are in fact compound or complex sentences. So, if you can apply... Ay, sorry. Hindi pala ako na-share. Di naka-present. Oo nga, Miss Adriano, naloko na. Ulitin natin. Babalik tayo din eh. So, ano yung dinagdag ni Gottlob Frege? Focus your attention on the sentence, if I'm going to Spain, then I will need a passport. Okay? This is an argument. If I'm going to Spain, then I will need a passport. That's an argument. Now, if you consider that argument in this way, you're actually saying that that argument can be translated into a compound sentence. Like so. Now, meaning to say, from the point of view of Gottlob Frege, all arguments can be considered as compound or complex sentences. Now, which means, if that is the case, then our analysis using tables like this of compound sentences can be used on arguments. Yan. Tabular, ang gusto sabihin natin, tabular analysis. Therefore, applies to arguments. Yan. So, ginawa natin ang analysis na ganito. Ano yung analysis na ganito, ha? O, tingnan nyo. Supposing you have this expression, if I'm going to Spain. So, and then you have this expression, I will need a passport. So, dalawa, I'm going to Spain, I will need a passport. You combine them into a compound sentence. If I'm going to Spain, then I will need a passport. And then you have another sentence. If it is true that if I'm going to Spain, I will need a passport. And it is true that I'm going to Spain, then it must be true that I will need a passport. Yan. So, ano ibig sabihin yan? Pwede kang mag-analyze ng argument. Premise, conclusion. And you can put it this way. Another way is, if I'm going to Spain, then I will need a passport. Then, I will need a passport, therefore I'm going to Spain. So, you have this S, sentence P. Then you say, if I'm going to Spain, I will need a passport. And it is true that I will need a passport, therefore I'm going to Spain. You can analyze this using the table. And with your analysis using the table, you can show how these two arguments are different mathematically. Okay, so let me now show it very quickly, and then we will get back to this later. So, as it is possible that S is true, P is true. It is possible that S is true, P is false. It's possible that S is false, but P is true. It's possible that S is false and P is false. Notice that there are only four possibilities. Both true, one false, one true, one false. Yan lang ang logically possible combination. Now, supposing you say, whenever something implies something, S implies P. When S implies P, and you know that S is true and P is true, then S implies P must be true. Let me repeat that. You can actually say, if S implies P and S is true and P is true, then you can say S implies P must be true. Yeah. Now you can also say, if something is false, you can imply anything. Let me repeat that. If something is false, you can imply anything. Paano nangyari yan? No, punta tayo sa akin. Ay, naloko na. Okay, balik tayo sa usapan natin. Ay, wala. Balik tayo sa akin, ha? Kung si Yao Ming ay pandak, maglolokohan tayo. Kung maglolokohan tayo, I can say ako ng pinakang gwapo sa balat ng lupa. Yan, ha? Tama ba, Miss Adriano? From something false, you can imply anything. That's a part of our intuition, given our language. From something false, what is an example of something false? Si Yao Ming ay pandak. Ay pagka si Yao Ming ay pandak, ako na ang pinakang gwapo sa balat ng lupa. From something false, you can imply anything. If you agree with that, then we can say what? We can say, from something false, you can imply something true. So true yan. From something false, you can imply something false, true rin yan. Okay? Now what happens? Now, you can now say, can something true imply something false? Can something true imply something false? That's the other question. Dito natin, can something true imply something false? Ganito, Miss Magdaong, nakakita ka na ba ng tao na nagkokolekta ng falsehood in his mind? Ay, this is something false. Oy, let me put it in my mind. Oh, ay, another falsehood. Let me put it in my mind. Oh, another falsehood. Pagka puno ng falsehood ng isipan ninyo, puta na, mamamatay kayo. Pagka nalasing ka, tapos ang dami na yung falsehood sa isipan mo, tapos naisip mo, ay, puta na, I can fly. So, punta ka doon sa fourth floor ng Palma Hall, talong ka, I can fly! Alaga pa ka doon sa ibaba, namatay ka. So, kung ang mangyari, something, someone puts falsehoods in his mind, the more falsehood, the more probability he will die. In a society, the more falsehoods we put in our society that everybody believes, the more chances that society will not survive. That's why fake news is terrible. Ngayon, ulitin natin, nalasing ka. Eh, dahil lasing ka, something pops up in your mind. And dahil marami kang falsehood in your mind, one of those falsehood pops up. And ano yung sabi nun? Kaya kong tigilin ang truck na ito. Ako ay si Superman. Punta ka sa gilalan ng kalsada, pinigil mo, puta na, nasa gasaan ka, patay ka. Yan. So, anong gusto nating sabihin, Miss Ibera? If something true, you are always collecting safe, more chances of survival. But if you're collecting something true and every time you collect something true, it leads you to something false, you die. So, sabi natin, well, hindi pwede yan. Something true can never imply something false. So sabi natin, false dito. Now, of course, we already know, if S is true, then S is true. I'm sorry. Dito natin, now, when S is true, then S is true. When S is false, then S is false. Same here. When P is true, P is true. When P is false, so, ang problema natin. So, ito. Ngayon, you have this argument represented in this analysis, tabular analysis. Now, take the other argument. This is a different argument. Now, what's the argument? Ito na, ano? Alam natin na yan. Eh. True, false. Sabi natin, this compound is only false when the first sentence is true, the second sentence is false. We call this first sentence antecedent, we call this the consequent. This is only false here. Elsewhere, it is always true. Okay, now we know when P is true, then P is true, and P is false. Now, you can now compare these two. You can now compare these two arguments mathematically. That's what we're saying. Yan. How do we compare them mathematically? Sandali, ha? View. Zoom out natin, ha? Zoom out ulit natin. Yan, o. Tingnan nyo din, eh. Notice, if you have this kind of argument, when all the premises are true, saan all premises to? True, the conclusion is also true. When all the premises are true, the conclusion is also true. But dito, you can have all premises true. True ito, conclusion true. Dito, true ito, conclusion false. Magkaiba yan. Dito, merong lusot. Ang tawag dito, lusot. Kahit totoo ang iyong batayan, pareho, pwede ring false ang iyong inaabtan. May lusot. Dito, kung totoo, lahat ng batayan, tsak na tsak, matuwid na matuwid, totoo ang inaabtan. And babalikan natin yan later. But, ay, nako, naloko na. Hindi na naman siya naka. Naka-share. Sorry. Balikan natin. Hindi na naman naka-share. Dito natin, ha? Sabi nga natin, yung argument na ito, pwede nating express as a compound sentence na ganito. Therefore, tabular analysis applies to the argument, to arguments. And this is an example of tabular analysis to arguments. We fill in the blanks. Sabi natin, something true can imply something true. True. So, true ito. So, yan. But sabi natin, something false can imply something, anything. If akong si Yao Ming ay pandak, ako nang pinakang gwapo sa balat ng lupa. So, from something false, you can imply anything. Therefore, you can imply true. True yan. Pag something false, you can imply false, true yan. Pero sabi natin, you can never imply something false from something true, because if that is the case, nag-iipo ka ng truth in your mind, then you also end up with falsehood, then you die. So that should not happen. So something true should never be able to imply something false. So sabi natin false. And so we're able to fill in the blanks. True, false, true, 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 false, false, true, false, true, false. Same here. We're able to fill in the blanks. True, false, true, false, true, true. True, false, true, false. True, true, false, false. Ano nga sabi natin? Makikita ninyo, dito sa katwiran na ito, kapag ang batayan na ito, at saka ito, at totoo pareho yung batayan, ano yan, ito, totoo, totoo, tsak na tsak, totoo ang inaabdan. Now, fortunately, yan lang dito yung merong totoo lahat ng batayan. So, 100% pag totoo lahat ng batayan, 100% totoo rin ang inaabdan. Pero dito, pwedeng mangyari, totoo ang batayan, pero ang inaabdan, totoo rin, pero 50% lang yan. Bakit dito, totoo rin ang batayan, pero pumapatak ay ang inaabdan ay hindi totoo. May lusot. Yan, hindi maayos yung katwiran na yan pagka ganyang may lusot. Bottom line is, makikita ninyo, pinakita ni Gottlob Frege na pwede palang gamitin ang mathematical analysis in terms of mathematical tables sa analysis ng compound sentences and therefore analysis ng argument. Ulitin natin. Doon sa work ni Gottlob Frege, nakita ng mga scholars at ng iba pang scholars, hindi lang si Bertrand at ng iba pang scholars, na pwede pala na yung paggamit ng mathematical tables kagaya nito, ma-apply natin sa analysis ng compound sentences and therefore ng mga arguments. At pag ginawa ninyo yan, makikita ninyo mathematically bakit itong argument na ito ay maayos, matuwid, at itong argument na ito ay baluktot, hindi maayos. Makikita natin kasi kaya hindi maayos kasi may lusot dito, totoo, dito, totoo rin. Pagkatapos dito naman, ang inaabtan ay hindi totoo, ay di hindi maayos. Yan. Okay ba? Tignan nyo ito, ha? Totoo. Ay, mali. Paano ba ito? Anyway, paano natin ayusin yan? So, ito totoo. Sorry, ito totoo. Ito totoo, pero dito hindi totoo. Ito totoo, ito totoo, ito totoo. 50% ng chance yung inaabtan hindi totoo. Sumantalang dito, 100%. Basta totoo ang batayan, 100% totoo inaabtan. Okay. Bottom line is, now we have mathematical logic as we have known it since then. Salamat kay George Boole na isipan natin gumamit ng symbolic language. Salamat kay Gottlob Frege na isipan natin na gumamit ng truth tables. Ang sunod na step, yung kay Bertrand Russell. Kasi ang nangyari, nag-fail si Gottlob Frege na magbigay ng magandang paliwanag dun sa kanyang unification of mathematics on the basis of set theory. So ang gustong mangyari ni Bertrand Russell, magbigay ng another way of unifying mathematics not using set theory, using something else. Ano yung something else na yon? Yung madidiscover na na yon, yun ang magbibigay daan sa computer technology. Yan. Pero hindi niya maisip yun kung hindi gawa ni Frege. Si Frege naman, hindi niya maisip yun kung hindi gawa ni George Boole. At si George Boole naman, hindi niya maisip yun kung hindi gawa ni Euclid, ni Descartes, at kung sino-sino pa. Hindi na natin matatapos ngayon yung usapan kasi inabot na ako na alauna eh. Maligayang araw po sa inyo lahat. Ingat lagi. Daming salamat. Pasensya na ha. Nagkakaletse-letse minsan yung aking sharing. Okay, maligayang araw po. Daming salamat nga. Ingat lagi. Bye-bye.